فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
This hadith was narrated by At-Tibyaan and Nasa'i. At-Tibyaan classified it as Hassan Sahih. There are many other authentic hadith on this matter. At-Darimi narrates with his chain that Ibn Abbas, may Allah be pleased with him, once said, "Whoever listens to a verse from the Book of Allah, that verse will be as light for him."
Pay attention to that. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, من استمع إلى آية, anyone who listens to a verse من كتاب الله, from the book of Allah, كانت له نورا, it will be a light for him in the day of judgment. That is going to be a light for you, just that one verse you listen to. What do you think about a person who listens to Quran all day, who's reading Mus'hafs all day, the Quran, he's always consistent upon the Quran, just by listening to one verse? Hasn't shaitan duped us in actually making us listen to music and replace the Quran with music, when we can actually get this? Sah? Naam.
Ibn Abi Dawood narrates that Abu Adanta would study the Quran with a group, and that they, the group, would recite it while gathered together.
This hadith, this statement of Ibn Abi Dawood from Abu Darda radiallahu ta'ala anhu, which is that كان يدرس القرآن مع نفر, he used to study the Quran with a group. يقرؤون جميعا, they will all read together. So this is what Somalis do, Suba. They'll read together, hey?
The virtue of reciting in groups is something that has been reported from groups among the prominent pious predecessors, those who came after them, and the early judges.
So this action of reading the Quran in groups, مجتمعين عن جماعات, من أفاضل السلف والخلف والقضاة, it's actually transmitted from the pious predecessors, the latecomers after the salaf, the khalaf. They did it as well. وَقُضَاتِ الْمُتَقَدِّمِينَ, and the jurists and the fuqaha, they did it. Now, so he's going to give you some difference of opinions here now. Are you?
Hassan ibn Atiyah and al-Awza'i.
So Hassan ibn Atiyah and al-Imam al-Awza'i rahimahullah, his name is AbdulRahman ibn Amr al-Awza'i. He's Imam al-Shami fi Asri. He's the Imam of the people of Sham, al-Imam al-Awza'i rahimahullah ta'ala,
are reported to have stated that the first person to start the tradition of studying in the masjid in Damascus is Hisham ibn Ismail, who initiated this practice upon arriving to Abdul Malik.
So the first person who actually started this practice, that Hassan ibn Atiyah and Awza'i both said, was what do you call it, Hisham ibn Ismail. When he came and visited Abdul Malik ibn Marwan, he started this in Dimashq, that the Quran be read and studied like this. So here, what you can sense from them is that they're saying that this wasn't present before them, before this action. Hey?
There are, however, reports from the predecessors that indicate dislike for group recitation.
So here, some of the Salaf actually ankara hadhi dirasa. They didn't actually allow it. They kind of rejected it and showed disapproval of it. Naam, waqal.
One such narration is that of Ibn Abu Dawood on the authority of Al-Dahak Ibn AbdulRahman Ibn Ahzab, who stated that he
Ibn Arzab. Arzab, yeah.
Ibn Arzab, who stated that he disliked studying in groups, and stated, "I have neither seen nor heard of this practice, and I have met the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam," meaning he did not see any of them doing that.
So he says, Al-Dhahak ibn AbdulRahman ibn Arzabin, he rejected this doing. And he said, "I haven't seen. Ma ra'aytu, I never saw. Wala sami'tu, and I never heard. Wa qad adraktu ashab Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam." I met the companions of the Prophet. Now, there's a point I need to mention here, which is very important, brothers. Wallahi, and I really want you guys to take this serious. And that is the concept of people saying, "I have never heard this before, nor have I seen it." This statement can come from a person who reads a lot, a person who studied, a person who met a lot of ulama, and took knowledge for a very long time. When he says, "I haven't heard or seen this," then okay, MashaAllah, okay, we can probably say, is this even valid? Does it exist? But ya akhi, you've not read nothing. You don't know anything about the religion. You see? And what do you say? Oh, I haven't heard this before. Like, that's gonna really change what? Some things that you hear people say, oh, well, I've never heard of that before. Or I've never seen this before. Ya akhi, open, what do you call it, 40 Nawis in there. 40 hadith of Nawis there. Wallahi, masail which are in the basic books. So this statement, I haven't seen, nor have I heard, is used by a scholar or a person of serious deep knowledge. Because his knowledge is very vast. A man came, an Imam al-Awza'i rahimahullah, said, an Imam Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, Muhammad ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, said, وَلَمْ يَثْبُتْ ذَلِكَ عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. This has not been authentically transmitted from the Prophet. This is what he said. Who's he like al-Zuhri? Imam Jabal is Imam Malik's teacher. And he's from the Sigar al-Tabi'in. He met some companions. Pay attention to this. When Zuhri said that, a young boy stood up and he said to Zuhri, أَحَفَظْتَ الْحَدِيثَ كُلَّهُ. Do you memorize all the hadith of the Prophet? Zuhri said, no. He said, do you memorize half of it? He said, no. He said, how do you know that this is not part of the half you don't know? Zuhri went quiet. Had Imam Zuhri, rahimahullah ta'ala. So when you say, I've never heard of this before, I don't, well, you don't know nothing about the religion, seriously. So it's most likely from the things you don't know. You haven't studied. You've never ever come to a circle of knowledge. You've never studied a book from beginning to end. Are you with me? So just because some people are born Muslims, they'll say this to you. I've never heard this. No, I've never seen this before. Really? I've never seen this. I've never heard and I've never seen it said by a person who knows, who studied. The statement that should come from a person who doesn't know anything should say, really? That's it. He should be amazed. Amazed with what? How his ignorance is vast. And acquire knowledge and gain knowledge. Are we all together? So when Shaykh Muhammad Nasiruddin Albani Mathalan says, فَبَحَثْتُ هَذِي الْمَسْأَلَ وَلَمْ أَجِدْهُ أَمَّا وَلَمْ أَجِدْ لَهُ تَرْجَمَةَ. I never found no biography for this person. You know as an individual, it's going to be hard for you to find it. صح. He said, I looked for this person and I couldn't find a biography on him. You now know it's going to be hard. But when an Ami person says to you, I don't know who this person is, you're going to say, okay, we'll just get Sirah Alamin Umilah, open it. The basic Tarjama book, you're going to open it, you find the Tarjama, here is his name. Okay. صح. Maybe even say, look at the bottom. Okay, here it is, there we go. It's right on the same page, right there. صح. نعم. So here him saying, مَا رَأَيْتُ وَلَا سَمِعْتُ actually is an indirect way, a humble way of him saying what? لَمْ يَصِّحْ ذَلِكَ. These people, their knowledge was vast. صح. But they were very humble in saying their speeches, right? Are you with me? You know why the Sahaba, the Tabi'een and the Sahaba never used to use the word haram? They used to use the word makruh. Why would they say makruh? It's min bab al-wara. Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا تَصِفُ أَلْسِنَتُكُمُ الْكَذِبَ هَذَا حَلَالٌ وَهَذَا حَرَامٌ لِتَفْتَرُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبَ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. So they were only, the reason why they didn't want to use haram is that conviction of saying haram. They had wara. They're like, Allah, subhanAllah, makruh, makruh. But they meant haram, but they wanted to use a lighter word. Because they, that conviction of cutting everything into and saying this is what it is and this is not it, for them, they had wara. They had that wara. Mm-hmm.
Ibn Wahab reported that he asked Malik, what do you say of those who gather and take turns in reciting verses from a chapter of the Quran until they complete it? He replied that he disliked such practice and refuted it, saying, this is not what the people, meaning the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, used to do. Instead, one man would recite while the other would listen to him, meaning correcting his recitation for him.
So, reading together. Somalis do that as well. Somalis, they have this, they do it as well. Which is that people, a person reads the Quran, and they read and read, and when it gets to the ending, because the Quran, in memorization wise, the ayat are always confused at the ending. Wallah bima ta'amaluna basiran, wallah basirun bima ya'amaluna, and stuff like that. People confused, right? So what they do is, so they can overcome that, everybody joins in at the ending of the verse. They call that hurin. Does that make sense? In the subah, they do it together. So when the person is about the ending, wallahu khabirun bima ta'amalun, they all come in together. They say it together. And the man, he reads his ayah by himself. And when he's at right ending, they all come in. This Mamalik rahimahullah and the Salaf really were harsh against that one. That all of them, one time with one recitation at once, they didn't like that. Or reading together one time, actually reading together. Like everybody comes, وَلَن تَرْضَ عَنْكَ الْيَهُودُ وَلَن نَصَارَى حَتَّى تَتَبِعَ مِلَّةً قُلْ إِنَّ هُدَى اللَّهِ. Everybody's in there together one time, one recitation, one vocal. They also went for it. But what they were open for, as Imam Malik says, إِنَّمَا كَانَ يَقْرَأُ الرَّجُلُ عَلَى الْآخَرِ يَعْرِضْهُ. That one would read and he would present it to the other one. Are you there? نعم.
This reputation, however, contradicts what the pious predecessors and those who came after them used to do.
And now Nawawi even rejects the view of who? The statement of Al-Dihak ibn Abdurrahman ibn Arzabin. And also the view of who? Al-Imam ibn Malik. Al-Imam Malik, rahimahullah. Al-Imam Malik. He actually goes against, he says, فَهَذَا الْإِنْكَارُ مِنْهُمَا. This, the rejection of both of them of who? Al-Dihak ibn Abdurrahman ibn Arzabin. And also Imam Malik, rahimahullah, he says, مُخَالِفٌ لِمَا عَلَيْهِ السَّلَفُ وَالْخَلَفُ. They are actually in a position to what the Salaf were upon. And they are actually in a position to what the Khalaf were upon. And they also are against what the evidence indicates. وَلِمَا يَقْتَضِيهِ الدَّلِيلِ. They're also against the evidence. فَهُوَ مَتْرُوكٌ. Their statement is rejected and is turned. We're not going to take Al-Imam Malik's view, nor we're going to take Al-Dihak ibn Abdurrahman ibn Arzabin. We're not going to take both of their opinions. Mm-hmm.
This opinion should therefore be ignored and left for the opinion that states that it is recommended. One must remember, however, that recitation in groups requires the conditions that we have counted out, that we have pointed out, and Allah knows best.
He spoke about it in page 10, 110 and 111. If you go to page 110 and 111, he tackles it there, and he speaks about it there, the conditions of when reading together in congregation, the conditions. So he doesn't accept this view of Imam Malik and the view of the Hakim ibn Abdurrahman ibn Arzabin. He doesn't accept it. He does not approve of it. Naam. That shows you what, brothers and sisters, it shows you that every individual after Allah and His Messenger are open to be accepted or to be rejected. So the view is, the scholars, what do they say? Everybody's view is between بين الراد والمردود. صح؟ بين الأخذ والرد. بين الأخذ والرد. Everybody's opinion is between acceptance and rejection. Everyone. Your view is looked at, it can either be taken and it can either be rejected. Whereas the Messenger and Allah is always going to be accepted. صح؟ Anyone. ولذلك الإمام مالك, what did he used to say? كل يؤخذ من قوله ويرد. Everybody, his view is either taken or rejected. إلا صاحب هذا القبر. Except the man in his grave. Referring to who? The Prophet. The one in his grave, his ones know. His one, everything he says. Because Imam Malik is teach from the Prophet's masjid. As for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, every single thing he says, we have to take it. But anybody other than the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, their speech is what? بين الأخذ والرد. It's between acceptance, accepting it and rejecting it. No.
There are any texts indicating the virtue of those who gather people together for recitation. Such evidence includes the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saying, "Whoever calls to good is like the doer of that good," meaning that they are equal with regards to the reward and virtue.
Mm-hmm. So the virtue of the one who brings the people together and makes them do this action, there are many textual evidences that actually show the virtue of it, such as Ad-Dalu ala al-Khayri kafa'ili. The one who makes the people do something, he teaches them and he indicates, he shows them something good, he's like the one who does it. Yeah? So if you come and you just show people something good, you may not necessarily even be the one who does it, but you show them something and they learn it and they start using it, such as as simple as you basically download an app for a person, a Quran app on their phone, and you teach them how to use it, and then you leave. And ever since that day that a person starts using that app on their phone and they read the Quran from it, you are going to get reward for that. You are going to get a reward for that. So it's something very great, and it's something very noble that you show the people good. You don't personally have to do it, but you get the reward for it.
He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said that Allah guide a single person by means of you is better than possessing red camels.
So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, for Allah to guide one person on your hand, through you Allah guides you, he guides one person on your hand. It's better for you. خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمْرِ النَّعْمِ. It's better for you what? حُمْرِ النَّعْمِ. It is better for you than a what? A red? We would say today, a Ferrari, a Bentley, huh? A Bugatti. It's better for you than that. For you to be given a Bugatti today, and for Allah to guide one hand, Abu Bakr is like, wow, Bugatti, huh? For Allah to guide that one person on your hand is better. May Allah guide us and guide many on our hands. So there's nothing better when a person calls you and says to you, I have benefited this from you, then it's far greater for you than thousands and thousands of millions being given to you. Wallahi. That a person tells you, Allah guided me to the Sunnah, or Allah guided me to Islam through a video of yours that I watched, or a little reminder that you gave me, or you know, a gathering of yours that I sat in, or just seeing you made my iman increase. These are things that are haqiqatan, it's greater for you than a red camel. Naam.
There are numerous other ahadith on this matter. Additionally, Allah says, and help one another upon good and piety. There is no doubt as to the greatness of the reward for he who strives to practice such actions.
This ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَعَوَنُوا, aid one another, support each other, عَلَى الْبِرِّ وَالتَّقْوَى. Righteousness and good, and piety, help each other on that, right? وَلَا تَعَوَنُوا, and don't help each other in what? عَلَى الْإِثْمِ وَالْعُدْوَانِ. Helping each other in good, صح? The good can be a good that benefits one individual, or it can be a good that benefits many. Help each other and aid each other.
Section on reciting the Quran in a group by taking turns. This is when a group of people gather in a circle so that one of them recites 10 verses or a chapter, and the next person then continues from where the last reciter left off. This is a permissible and praiseworthy action. And when Malik, may Allah have mercy on him, was asked about it, he replied, there is nothing wrong with that.
So that's the statement of Imam Malik. La ba'sa bihi. There's no harm regarding it. And it generally falls under the statements of the Prophet ﷺ. مَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِّن بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ فِي مَا بَيْنَهُمْ إِلَّا حَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةُ وَغَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةُ وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ وَمَنْ بَطَأَ بِهِ عَمَلُهُ لَمْ يُسْرِعْ بِهِ نَسَبُهُ. It falls under that hadith. So it's permissible. La ba'sa bi. Suba' for the Somali community that read it like that, it's permissible, there's no problem. Rather, I find it to be one of the strongest ways to keep the memorization of the Quran. It is. But it's good when the numbers are little. When the number is little. If the number goes big and large, it's not good. That's why I'm not fond of the Saturday Suba'. It's too big, man. Five people now. But then when you reach Juz'amma or Tabarak, it becomes 30, 40 people start kicking in. You broke it now into two. Good. فَصْلٌ فِي رَفْعِ الصَّوْتِ بِالْقِرَاءَ هَذَا فَصْلٌ مُهِمٌ يَنْبَغِي أَنْ يُعْتَنَى بِهِ اِعْلَمْ أَنَّهُ جَاءَتْ أَحَادِيثُ كَثِيرَةٌ فِي الصَّحِيحِ وَغَيْرِهِ دالة على استحباب رفع الصوت بالقراءة وجاءت آثار دالة على استحباب الإخفاء وخفض الصوت وسنذكر منها طرفا يسيرا إشارة إلى أصلها إن شاء الله تعالى. قال أبو حامد الغزالي وغيره من العلماء وطريق الجمع بين الأخبار والآثار المختلفة في هذا أن الإصرار أبعد من الرياء فهو أفضل في حق من يخاف ذلك فإن لم يخف الرياء فالجهر ورفع الصوت أفضل لأن العمل فيه أكثر ولأن فائدته تتعدى إلى غيره والنفع المتعدي أفضل من اللازم ولأنه يوقظ قلب القارئ ويجمع همه إلى الفكر فيه ويصرف سمعه إليه ويطرد النوم ويزيد في النشاط ويوقظ غيره من نائم أو غافل وينشطه قالوا فمهما حضره شيء من هذه النيات فالجهر أفضل فإن اجتمعت هذه النيات تضاعف الأجر قال الغزالي ولهذا قلنا القراءة في المصحف أفضل فهذا حكم المسألة وأما الآثار فكثيرة وأنا أشير إلى أطراف من بعضها ثبت في الصحيح عن أبي هريرة رضي الله تعالى عنه قال سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول ما أذن الله لشيء ما أذن لنبي حسن الصوت يتغنى بالقرآن يجهر به رواه البخاري ومسلم ومعنى أذن استمع وهو إشارة إلى رضا والقبول وعن أبي موسى الأشعري رضي الله عنه أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال له لقد أوتيت مزمارا من مزامير آل داود رواه البخاري ومسلم وفي رواية مسلم أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال لو رأيتني وأنا أستمع إلى قراءتك البارحة رواه مسلم أيضا من رواية بريد بن الحصيب وعن فضالة بن عبيد رضي الله عنه قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم لله أشد أذنا إلى الرجل الحسن الصوت بالقرآن من صاحب القينة إلى قينته رواه ابن ماجه وعن أبي موسى أيضا قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إني لأعرف أصوات رفقة الأشعريين بالليل حين يدخلون رفقة الأشعريين بالليل حين يدخلون وأعرف منازلهم من أصواتهم بالقرآن بالليل وإن كنت لم أرى منازلهم حين نزلوا بالنهار رواه مسلم رواه البخاري ومسلم وعن البراء بن عازب رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم زينوا القرآن بأصواتكم رواه أبو داود والنسائي وغيرهما وروى ابن أبي داود عن علي رضي الله عنه أنه سمع ضجة ناس في المسجد يقرؤون القرآن فقال طوبى لهؤلاء كانوا أحب الناس إلى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وفي إثبات الجهر أحاديث كثيرة وأما الآثار عن الصحابة والتابعين من أقوالهم وأفعالهم فأكثر من أن تحصر وأشهر من أن تذكر وهذا كله في من لا يخاف رياء ولا إعجابا ولا نحوهما من القبائح ولا يؤذي جماعة بلبس صلاتهم وتخليطها عليهم وقد نقل عن جماعة من السلف اختيار الإخفاء لخوفهم مما ذكرناه فعن الأعمش قال دخلت على إبراهيم وهو يقرأ في المصحف فاستأذن عليه رجل فغطاه وقال لا يرى هذا أني أقرأ كل ساعة وعن أبي العالية قال كنت جالسا مع أصحاب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ورضي عنهم فقال رجل قرأت الليلة كذا فقالوا هذا حظك منه ويستدل لهؤلاء بحديث عقبة بن عامر رضي الله عنه قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول الجاهر بالقرآن كالجاهر بالصدقة الجاهر بالقرآن كالجاهر بالصدقة والمسر بالقرآن كالمسر بالصدقة رواه أبو داود والترمذي والنسائي وقال الترمذي هذا حديث حسن وقال الترمذي معنى هذا الحديث أن الذي يسر بقراءة القرآن أفضل من الذي يجهر بها لأن صدقة السر أفضل عند أهل العلم من صدقة العلانية قال وإنما معنى هذا عند أهل العلم لكي يأمن الرجل من العجب لأن الذي يسر بالعمل لا يخاف عليه من العجب كما يخاف عليه من علانيته قلت وكل هذا موافق لما تقدم تقريره في أول الفصل من التفصيل وأنه إن خاف بسبب الجهر شيئا مما يكره لم يجهر وإن لم يخف استحب الجهر فإن كانت القراءة من جماعة مجتمعين تأكد استحباب الجهر لما قدمناه ولما يحصل فيه من نفع غيرهم والله تعالى أعلم.
Section on raising voice during recitation. This is an important topic and one that deserves attention.
This is now a chapter where he talks about raising your voice and reading loudly. في رفع الصوت بالقراءة. When you're reading the Quran, reading with a loud voice. هذا فصل مهم. This is a very important chapter. ينبغي أن يعتنى به. It should be given a lot of attention and a lot of consideration should be given to this chapter. اعلم نو.
Although there are many ahadith in Al-Bukhari indicating that raising the voice while reciting is recommended, there are also many reports suggesting that it is better to lower the voice and conceal it as in whispering. We will, inshallah, be mentioning some of these reports and explain what they are based on.
Here the author, rahimahullah, he mentions that there are two views regarding this issue. One view that says, raising the voice in recitation is recommended. And there are many textual evidences for that, he says. Ahadith which are in Sahih al-Bukhari. Okay? He also says, وَجَاءَتْ آثَارٌ And there's also other statements. Which is what? دَالَّةٌ that indicate عَلَى اسْتِحْبَابِ الْإِخْفَاءِ وَخَفْضِ الصَّوْتِ The other one, which is the second opinion, that mentions reciting the Qur'an at a very low volume, at a very low voice. And not to raise it loudly. There are many evidences that come regarding that, and that is recommended. And he says, وَسَنَذْكُرُ مِنْهَا طَرَفًا يَسِيرًا إِشَارَةً إِلَىٰ أَصْلِهَا إِنْشَاءَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ And he says, we're going to mention some of them from those evidences. So there are two opinions now. One opinion is saying that raise your voice, read the Quran loud, and that it recommends you to do that. And there are other evidences that come that mention al-istihbab al-ikhfa'i wa khafd al-sawt that the person hides his righteous deed and he lowers his voice. Now,
Imam Abu Hamid al-Ghazali and other scholars have said, and the way to resolve the conflict, these different statements.
Abu Hamid al-Ghazali now, and not only him but also other ulama, what they try to do is they try to reconcile between the two opinions. So Abu Hamid al-Ghazali says, وَطَرِيقُ الْجَمْعِ بَيْنَ الْأَخْبَارِ وَالْآثَارِ الْمُخْتَلِفَةِ فِي هَذَا The way to reconcile between these akhbar, these narrations, and these textual evidences, these different textual evidences and these akhbar is, نعم.
The way is to, if concealing one's voice keeps one away from the riyah, which is to do or say something with the intent of showing off or flaunting, an act that is strictly prohibited, and is in the category of shirk. then this is better, this is the better option for the individual who fears falling into such a wrongdoing. If one does not fear falling into this, then reciting in a loud voice is better, as it requires more effort and its benefits extend to others, which is better than being limited to a single individual.
Here the author, rahimahullah, he divides it into two. He says that, so he responds by saying that if the person, he says first of all, أَنَّ الْإِصْرَارَ أَبْعَدُ مِنَ الرِّيَا. Reading low and keeping your volume low is actually further from showing off. To actually read with a lower volume is further from showing off. So from that angle, it is better for the one who fears that he may fall into showing off, that he puts his he lowers his voice. Okay? But if the one, if that individual doesn't fear that he might show off, he's not scared. فَإِلَّمْ يَخْيَ فِي الرِّيَاءِ. I'm not scared, I'm not going to show off, alhamdulillah. I can read it loud and I'm not showing off. فَالْجَهَلُ وَرَفْعُ الصَّوْتِ أَفْضَلُ. Then he should raise, keep his voice loud. The reason for him to keep his voice loud is better now is because what he's going to do is he's going to probably encourage others to do it. Or he's also going to benefit other people by listening to that recitation of his. And the reward that's connected to you alone, the righteous deeds that's connected to you alone, is not as good as if you bring others in. He brings a qa'idah here, which is وَالنَّفْعُ الْمُتَعَدِّي أَفْضَلُ مِنَ اللَّازِمِ, he says. نَفْعُ الْمُتَعَدِّي, which is the transitive deeds, righteous deeds, is greater than the intransitive deeds. Which is that the things that's exclusive to you is not as good as if it's what? If it brings others in. Okay? So that's why he... So do you see how he reconciled between all the evidences? Yeah.
Reciting in a loud voice also awakens the heart of the reciter and allows him to focus on contemplating the Qur'an and listening to it more carefully.
So even one of the benefits that it holds as well is that you as an individual are also more pondering. Like when you read the Qur'an loud, you actually can ponder more and you can hear your voice and you can... It makes you actually alert and aware, and in that regard, and it also distances you from sleeping, right? It does. Naam. And it also even increases enthusiasm in you, and it also wakes up those who are sleeping as well, right? It brings them into the righteous deeds with you.
It is also helpful in that it keeps away drowsiness, causes the reciter to become more alert and prevents others from becoming drowsy and absent-minded. The scholars have also said that reciting in a raised voice is better regardless of whether or not the reciter forms any of these intentions or not. But to form such intentions multiplies his reward. Al-Ghazali, may Allah be pleased with him, also states, this is why we hold the opinion that reading from the Mus'haf is better than reading the Qur'an from memory. Meaning, due to some of the common benefits we have just mentioned, and this is the ruling on the matter. Mm-hmm. Many narrations have been transmitted on this issue, and I will mention just a few. On the authority of Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, I heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saying, Allah listens to nothing as he listens to a prophet reciting the Qur'an in a beautiful and raised voice. This suggests that Allah approves of this action and is pleased with it. Bukhari and Muslim narrated this hadith.
So here the author says there are going to be many textual evidences that he's going to bring to prove that raising the voice is praiseworthy as well. And he brought the hadith of Abu Hurairah radiyallahu ta'ala anhu that he said, I heard the Prophet say, مَا أَذِينَ اللَّهُ. The word أَذِينَ means istama'a. أَذِينَ means istama'a. And it doesn't mean just istama'a. It means that Allah listens and is actually pleased with it and he accepts it. لِشَيْءٍ something. مَا أَذِينَ لِنَبِيٍّ. Allah is not more attentive in listening anything greater than a prophet reciting with beautiful voice and loudly the Qur'an. Allah really is pleased with that and he loves it. And he listens to it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, مَا أَذِنَ اللَّهُ لِشَيْءٍ مَا أَذِنَ لِنَبِيٍ حَسَنُ الصَّوْتِ. حَسَنِ الصَّوْتِ. حَسَنِ الصَّوْتِ means what? Whose voice is beautiful. يَتَغَنَّى بِالْقُرْآنِ يَجْهَرُ بِهِ. He's reading his voice, the Qur'an, with a nice, beautiful recitation. Okay? يَجْهَرُ بِهِ. And then he's doing jahr. Jahr means what? loudly. He's reading it what? He's reading it loudly. Naam. No.